And so have we got a duo for you. Our next guest grew up in a Mormon household, came out in his senior year of college, and then went on to write the Oscar award-winning screenplay for Milk about, yes, we can actually give that a round of applause. An AIDS activist and founder of the American Foundation for Equal Rights. He also produced and directed 8, the Mormon Proposition about the Gay Rights Amendment in California. We are enormously pleased to welcome to the foundation screenwriter, producer, director, Dustin Lance Black, and from the NYU Law School, Professor Kenji Yoshino. Please.
Thank you. Hi there. Hi, Richard. What?
So it's really great to be here, and it's an honor to be able to sit with Lance here. We really are going to structure this as a conversation, so I'm going to kick it off with a few questions, and we'll have some back and forth, and then we'll open it up to you for Q&A. And I'm told that we have a hard stop at 2. So we'll try and leave ample time for questions. So I guess I want to begin on the storytelling theme, Lance. So one of my favorite cases, I teach law and literature, and one of my favorite cases is actually not a gay rights case at all. It's this 2000 case called the United States versus Dickerson, which has to do with whether or not the Congress can supersede the Miranda warning, or whether or not the Miranda warning has a constitutional dimension. And the Supreme Court, Chief Justice Rehnquist writing the opinion, says the Miranda warning has become so much a part of our national culture that we can't get rid of it even if we wanted to. So we assume that then Chief Justice Rehnquist is not a fan of the Miranda warning, but he says, you know, this has become so much of a part of our culture that even if we wanted to get rid of it, we couldn't get rid of it. What I find fascinating about this opinion is that this is not the executive branch as a co-equal interpreter of the Constitution, or Congress as a co-equal interpreter of the Constitution. This is Hollywood as a co-equal interpreter of the Constitution. Essentially, what Chief Justice Rehnquist is saying is there have just been too many episodes of Law and Order for us to get rid of the Miranda warning, because there'd be a lot, there'd be 300 million confused people out there if, you know, we got rid of it, right? So I guess my first question to you, Lance, is like, how is that cultural change happening? Because it's clearly happening in a way that the court is noticing, or hopefully about to notice even more, right? Uh-huh. And so how has the storytelling on that the LGBT movement has done been equivalent to sort of embedding, you know, LGBT norms and rights into the culture, and the way the Miranda warning has been embedded by Hollywood in the culture?
Right. Well, I think one of the things that is particular to the LGBT movement is this problem the movement has always suffered from, which is invisibility. That gay and lesbian people can, for the most part, remain invisible. If I have 2 or 3 cocktails, I'm certainly not invisible anymore. I become a little more flamboyant. But it's a movement that can remain hidden easier than other minority movements. And so one of the things that I think in Hollywood we've been able to be helpful with is to start to depict LGBT people, and hopefully, and I don't think we're quite there yet, in all of our diversity. And to really demonstrate that we are everywhere, we work in every sort of job, we come in every color, we attend every sort of church there is, and to start to break down those myths and lies and stereotypes that have kind of plagued the movement for so long. I think that happened because about 15, almost 20 years ago, we started to see that there was profit to be had in depicting LGBT characters, that people would tune in, people were interested. And I think James Seamus is here somewhere. I don't know if he's here yet. But the bravery of greenlighting something like Brokeback Mountain and Milk, and to see that they actually made money so that they continue to tell and continue to greenlight LGBT stories in Hollywood, or the success of something like Will and Grace, which also said, hey, if you tell gay and lesbian stories, and gay and lesbian storylines. You can actually make money at it, so let's continue to do it. And in that way, Hollywood has taken the invisible and made them incredibly visible. And I say time and again, I believe truth is on our side. And the more light we can shine on who we are and all of our glorious diversity, the more our truths are told, the more people will relate to us, and the sooner we'll be free. And so I think in that way, Hollywood has helped.
And do you want us to get you some cocktails? Because you can become more and more visible over the...
I'm in New York. Is it, what time is it? It's almost 1 o'clock, right?
That's right. It's 5 o'clock in Europe.
All right.
We were talking earlier, Lance, about the different kind of possibilities for storytelling in different forums. So could you talk a little bit about that? Because you obviously, one of the hats that wasn't mentioned was that you obviously were and are one of the board members of the American Foundation for Equal Rights, the group that sponsored the Perry versus Schwarzenegger litigation, right? So clearly you had some sense of a story being able to be told in the courts in a way that hadn't been possible in the referendum or the ballot process.
So. Well, this you should speak to. You know more than I do the power of the courtroom. And if this is a movement of storytelling, and I'll beat that drum over and over and over again, if this is a movement of storytelling to get the truth out, to dispel the old lies about who gay and lesbian people are, I was getting increasingly frustrated seeing our stories being told through ballot box initiatives. The initiative process was incredibly frustrating to me because I think we all know and are exhausted from the lack of truth-telling over the past year as we've seen many of our issues and other issues go to the ballot box, and there's not a lot of truth-telling on television and political ads. You don't have to. You're not being held to account. You can present all the junk science that you want. You can tell all the lies you'd like to tell. And the place that, you know, I just knew from watching television what happens in a courtroom. You raise your right hand, you have to promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but, and there are penalties if you don't. And I thought, what a wonderful place for gay and lesbian people to finally be able to tell our stories. Mm-hmm. What a wonderful venue for storytelling. That if the other side comes in and starts trying to say the things they say on these ads during these ballot initiatives, that they're going to be held to account, that it's going to be challenged. We're going to be able to shoot down the junk science and to counter some of these hateful claims that they've been making for generations now. And we'll be able to tell our stories in a protected venue. Mm-hmm. And so that was really, as we were starting to talk about what were next steps, what were our frustrations with Proposition 8, where could we take this, was to say, hey, let's take this not only to court, but to federal court. And for me, that's a more personal mission. I grew up in Texas. I grew up in Virginia. I grew up in states that I don't think we'll see equality for some time if we just continue the ballot initiative process. And I want these decisions to apply to all my brothers and sisters in all 50 states. So courts, because it's the place to tell our stories, I think, and then federal, so that we're not leaving our brothers and sisters behind. That was where this case came from for me. It's still about storytelling. And I think you said it pretty well, what it is that happens in court that's different. Than what happens, right? I mean, this is your world.
Well, I did opine that being under oath for open-ended periods of time of cross-examination makes the courts into a truth commission in a different way. But I definitely feel like I am this is a new good ego experience for me. I feel like I am the coleslaw and you are the hamburger in this exchange. So I'm gonna, have
Whoa.
The focus move towards you.
All right. So,
is there a moment?
I'm not sure what that means.
You're in the main event, is what I'm trying to say.
We'll jump in at any time because I'm not a lawyer,
Fair
and
enough.
In this case, I really lean on Ted Olson and David Boies for the legal advice. Like, there's all these lofty ideas that say I and Chad Griffin, who's now over at HRC doing this great work, have, but without the advice of people who actually know how to make it happen, we wouldn't be as far as we are now. Mm-hmm. I will tell you, the moment I knew it was working and that we were doing the right thing, because there was a lot, trust me, some of you in this room probably wrote me some nasty emails when we filed this case, But the moment I knew we were doing the right thing is when the opposition, we had to go to trial, which we weren't necessarily expecting. The judge wanted to have a trial, and that was exciting and frightening, but I thought, boy, this is what we wanted, an opportunity to get the truth out. I knew we were doing the right thing when the other side went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court to make sure cameras couldn't be in that room. Mm-hmm. They were afraid of the truth that was going to come out in there, and it was clear they were afraid of the truth-telling that was going to take place in that courtroom. And that was heartbreaking going into it. It was more heartbreaking day after day after day, seeing this incredibly moving testimony, seeing that the witnesses for the opposition of equality wouldn't even come into the room, most of them. They know how thin their science is. They know there's nothing to back up these opinions in a court of law. That only one witness on marriage, expert on marriage, was willing to come into that courtroom. And before it was all said and done, he had turned on the stand and said that the day that we adopt same-sex marriage that this country will be more American. That was one of the opposition's, their only expert on marriage. Mm-hmm. And so then I said, okay, well, if you won't let the country see it, I want to, it became my next creative project. I want to take the transcripts, redact it into a 90-minute play, and take that around the country, because I think people need to be informed of what happens when you're held to account to tell the truth on LGBT issues. And that's where the play 8 has come from.
Yeah, I mean, there's a way, if you think about great trials in our nation's history, oftentimes the theatrical representations of them overtake the actual events themselves. So think about Inherit the Wind and the Scopes trial, for example,
sure.
Right? So is there any sense that where you still regret those trial transcripts? In some ways, it's like even if they release the tapes now, right, mm-hmm. Nobody is going to sit through a 12-day trial watching it 8 hours a day.
Whereas, I would. it was really moving. If they release those tapes, there is not. I mean, I hats off to the actors who have, across the country, who've been in the play, and they've done a great job. But it was so incredibly moving what happened in that courtroom day after day after day. Some of it I would probably gets a little dense, but you could make a beautiful documentary if and when I hope one day we get to see the footage of the rest of the world gets to see the footage of what happened in there. The only problem with this case, as opposed to say Inherit the Wind, is that the opposition didn't bring much of a case, and it was very thin because I think a lot of them. In initial depositions with David Boies, saw what they were up against, saw that they were going to be held to account for the things they've been saying for decades out there in their op-eds or this sort of flimsy science, and they didn't show up. One of them in particular, one of the founders of Prop 8, William Tam, he evaded the subpoenas to appear. We had to try and get him to appear. So they didn't have much of a case. So in terms of real drama, it was tough, and I had to really mine any moment they almost made a point so that there would be some drama in the play. I know. So if you ever get a chance to see it and go, it's on. We were really fortunate. We got Brad Pitt and George Clooney and Martin Sheen was fantastic. And we did this big Hollywood production of it, and it's on YouTube still. They gave us the rights to keep it up there. Check it out. Like, at a certain point, you can see me going, if I don't turn this into a comedy and a farce, it's not going to work. And at a certain point, it becomes very funny like that. It was the only place you could go.
Yeah, and you mentioned that there have been productions of this all around the country on the order of 400, is that right?
Yeah, about 400.
Yeah, so what is that experience? You said that it actually has turned into a comedy in some of the productions. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, it didn't start off as comedy. It started out, it's a drama. And it's using the real words from the case, just redacted. And we finally, after it's gone to all of these colleges and community theaters, and it did, it was here on Broadway and in LA, and did all these big productions, someone had this idea, let's try and take it to high schools. And I thought, oh my goodness, it is so dense. This is David Boies and Ted Olson, is dense sort of testimony. And I thought the kids would be bored or it'd be terrible. And I showed up to this high school in Woodland Hills, the first high school to do it. And the kids are all dressed up in their dad's suits and, looking awfully adorable, and they're great with the words, And I have not heard so much laughter from an audience ever in a production of one of these things, because these kids are of a generation where they're like, these people sound like my stupid parents on this issue. Mm-hmm. Like, can you believe they're up there saying these things about LGBT people, that this is even an issue? And they found it to be like the best comedy of the year, I think. Which is telling for where this movement is going, that we have a generation that just can't wrap their heads around why this is an issue at all. And it's frustrating sometimes to talk to them about it, but it means that we're heading in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. In terms of the right direction, I mean, a lot of the work that you do comes from your faith background, right, as well as your LGBT background, or having grown up Mormon, I should probably say more accurately. So can we expect the Mormon Church to actually turn on this issue? You know, I'm sort of perhaps crazily hopeful relative to, say, the Roman Catholic Church hierarchy turning, because the Mormon Church is relatively young. It's in this country. You know, are we going to see any movement on that
front? Right. I think we can. I did grow up Mormon. I don't know why they're still talking to me after Big Love and now doing Under the Banner of Heaven in March. But I've stayed in close contact with them, because I think that is something that we have to work hard to do, is to stay in contact with our roots, with our faith communities, with our families. It's so much easier. Trust me, I know it, for me it would be easier just to kind of walk away. But I was showing you or telling you about in the green room, I got a text message from the head of the PR department of the Mormon Church inviting me to the Mormon Tabernacle Choir Christmas Spectacular, which is their... It's as close as they get to the Academy Awards for the Mormons. But that's, you know, a big deal for them. And I'll go. I've gone once before, and I'll go again. And in those meetings, we've been able to start to bring in gay and lesbian families. Now, I'm telling you, part of the issue with the Mormon Church is you start to rise through the ranks, and it's usually based on how long you've been in, say, the Quorum of the 70, turns into the 12, turns into the Prophet. And so these guys are, you know, they're quite old, and they've grown up in these insular communities, usually in Provo and Orem, and they have not, even when you say gay and lesbian family, they say, what is that? What does that mean? What does that even look like? And they don't know. And so over the past 3 years, since they've shown a willingness to at least meet us and to meet gay and lesbian families, I think it's been very eye-opening for them. And to see the warmth that they've had in inviting us to some of their more public events, and to go to the Mormon Tabernacle Christmas Spectacular 2 years ago, and the front VIP line is all filled with gay and lesbian families and their kids, I thought, okay, at least we're introducing ourselves. That's the first step. Real change has started to come in when Monson, President Monson, about, I guess it's 2 years ago now, did not just He gave an affirmative stance on employment and housing non-discrimination for gay and lesbian people for the first time. They'd actually started moving that direction and taking a non-stance, saying, you know, we just don't want to get involved in this for years. And he was finally held to account by someone named Brandy Balkin, who runs Equality Utah, and she is a fantastic, I hope she's leading our movement soon. And she really held the church to account and said, you cannot... be neutral on this issue anymore. And Monson, the president of the church, came out with this affirmative stance. And Brandy Balkin, with that, has been able to turn one county every month since into a pro-LGBT equality in terms of housing and employment non-discrimination. So she's 16 for 16 months right now in changing Utah. And to see what happens in that church, because people, unlike perhaps when the Pope comes out with a new decision and Catholics kind of consider that, When the prophet of the Mormon Church comes out with a decision, you do it. And the Deseret News, the conservative paper out there in Salt Lake City, had a poll that came out a week and a half after the president of the church said that. And the numbers had moved from something like 80% against employment non-discrimination to 60% for. Mm-hmm. And that's a massive change in, you know, 7 to 10 days. Mm-hmm. And, right? Mm-hmm. So in that way... And that way, I think there's hope. It's tough when it comes to the issue of marriage with the Mormons. And it's something that we have to, I think, continue to introduce ourselves, not just to the Mormons, but to every faith community, so they can meet our families, understand, start to see our families in an eternal way. in a way that fits in with their vision of eternity. And that's toughest with Mormons, and I'll tell you why. And it's the fight I've been having with them. And I grew up this way, that the Mormons believe that the reason you come to this planet is to get married, so that you have a partner to help procreate your future planet. And I know it sounds nutty, but it's what I grew up believing too. I don't so much anymore. But I did say in these meetings with these, good Mormon leaders, and we were starting to debate this issue a little bit. And they said, well, we don't know. We can't figure out what gay and lesbians, why you would get married here, and how would you populate your future planet? And I said, well, if we are to be future gods, and we're going to be omnipotent, and all-powerful, in the future, I think if we were able to figure out artificial insemination on this planet, we'll be able to figure it out on our next planet.
Absolutely.
And they all sat there turning red, and I said, it's okay, you can laugh. Right. And they burst forth laughing. And I'm hoping that these are sort of the moments and the conversations that you have to have in faith communities to start to get to see them to see our families as equal to heterosexual families. Mm-hmm.
So populating planets through adoption and surrogacy.
Whatever it takes.
Your mail has changed, I imagine, over the years. So where was the tipping point where the hate mail that you got from the LGBT community for bringing this case, or sponsoring this case, flip over? Is there a definite cusp where your love mail exceeds your hate mail?
Yeah, because I did get some, I got a good, I'm only laughing because I see some of the faces I got hate mail from in this room. And I get it. I mean, honestly, like, I was so new to this thing, and the people who sent me the mail had been doing this for far longer, and know better than I do what needed to be done, I think. And so this was just sort of it was a bold move, but I had full faith in it, because I have full faith in a couple of things. I'm a student of Harvey Milk. And I believe that we cannot continue to ask for crumbs, and I do not believe in incrementalism. That's my point of view. I think that if I'm going to convince my union truck-driving, NASCAR-loving uncle in Texas that I deserve full equality, what he wants me to see is demand full equality. It's like, you want me to respect you? Show respect for yourself. Don't ask for a bit of it here and a bit of it there. Then I think that's all you think you deserve. You want to see somebody ask for everything. So it was a bold move to go federal, to ask for it all, and to do it now. Mm-hmm. And it was based on this idea that we needed to do the biggest, the boldest truth-telling campaign possible in the greatest venue possible. And so I just crossed my fingers for the day that those transcripts started coming out of that courtroom, which were immediate. So the day for day one, transcripts, first day of transcripts come out. And that's where it started to change. And I think that's where I started getting emails saying, hey, I see it. I see what's happening in there. Mm-hmm. And we're getting our story out. And guess what? People, even though the cameras are banned, and probably because cameras were banned and they've made such a huff about it, people were paying attention. Mm-hmm. And so then it started to change. And I think people started saying, hey, it's nice. God, it feels good to have the court watching out for the truth about us and our families.
Yeah. This is a little bit of a hardball question, but I mean, Ted doesn't ask for a trial initially. He wants to get this up before the Supreme Court on a preliminary injunction within like 6 months or a year, right? So what flips him? I mean, the judge is basically issuing a guilt-edged invitation saying, I want a trial, and he's pushing back with a preliminary injunction. And I realize this is law talk, so if you don't want to go into the weeds on that, that's fine.
No, I get it.
But what changed for him? Because as in your telling, which I totally agree with, it's the fact that there was a trial in this case that matters. So why was the initial strategy not to ask for that trial?
You know, I think that, I mean, the initial, listen, it was something we never thought that even the judge would want in the case. Mm-hmm. We saw sort of a long, we thought our fight was going to come much later. Mm-hmm. And I remember the day, I don't know how much insider I'm supposed to talk about, but I shouldn't care. The day that we found out that he wanted a trial was a a day of great challenges, because we thought, okay, now we have to do a lot of fundraising. You know, we want to make sure if we're going to do a trial, we want to make sure we do it right. But it was a day of great joy for us. Mm-hmm. I think the plaintiffs were sweating it, because now they knew they were going to have to testify in front of the world. But it was never something that we were resistant to or afraid of. It was something we embraced and were quite excited about. We just never expected it going into it. We thought, like every other case like this, every other federal case, it would be filings. We'd be filing. And I think we just were moving forward in that way. So I think Ted Olson wants to get it done. You know, that's how he works. And I wish he was here to answer this question. But, you know, for him, he thought, he is so convinced that this is the right thing to do, not the blue thing to do or the red thing to do, the conservative thing or the liberal thing to do, but the right thing to do, and it makes sense according to the law, that for him, he's like, I just want to get it done. I want to get it done now, and I want to get it done in the fastest, quickest, most efficient way possible so that you guys can get on with your lives. Mm-hmm. And he would say that all the time. So this did make it last a lot longer. Mm-hmm. So I think for him, it's probably that, because he's kind of an efficiency-minded, get-it-done kind of guy. Mm-hmm. But boy, we were all real excited to get the trial done.
Yeah, and I can't resist asking you about Ted. He recently came to NYU and was interviewed by Rachel Maddow, boys and he together. And Rachel was great because she said, you know, you're helping Paul Ryan prepare for the debate.
Oh, right? No, that was uncomfortable.
Yeah. And so why is it that you're pretending to be Biden helping Paul Ryan? You know, get ready for this debate to help, which will help Romney win, which will change the composition of the Supreme Court, which will make your case impossible to win, right? So, and he had an interesting answer to that, which was the non-interesting part of it was, you know, I can do more from within. I mean, it's, you know, not a bad answer. It's just what you would expect him to say.
Right.
The interesting part of the answer was actually, I can do more in the persona of Joe Biden in terms of attacking Paul Ryan's position on marriage than I can in the persona of Ted Olson, because we're supposed to play nicely with each other when I'm Ted Olson. But, you know, when I'm Joe Biden, I can really go for the jugular, right?
Right.
But my question for you is, what were your team dynamics like with Ted Olson? Because he's taking, like, short breaks from the Perry case to go litigate Citizens United, right?
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, it wasn't just him either. I mean, we worked really hard to make sure that this was a sort of multi-partisan, effort, that we have all kinds of views on our board and whatnot. So it's also Ken Millman, you know, sort of the architect of the Bush campaign, and the anti-gay marriage initiatives that went up, 8 years ago now. It was never uncomfortable. It's usually really funny. I mean, when you got to understand, when Ted and David get in a room, it's comedy, and none of us agree for the most part. Very few of us agree on anything other than the marriage issue with Ted Olson, and he loves that. He loves talking about it and watching us turn red, and you know, it just becomes dinner banter. And the more wine, the more freely we all yell at each other about those sorts of things. But it's so important. It feels so momentous, really, because I do LGBT work, and it's always lovely to sort of preach to the choir and talk amongst to your own, and it's a lot of sort of progressive people, and that's all very nice. But that's not the case in our rooms at AFER. There's a lot of different ideas and a lot of things we disagree about. And it's so exciting to be in the room and listen to conservatives talk about LGBT equality. And it's not the way my mind works. It's the way their mind works. But I need to learn that so that I can take that, those ideas, that way, that perspective on LGBT equality, and use that and that language with my own family. I mean, my own family is Mormon and from Texas and military. And I found it incredibly useful and healing for my family. And so I thank Ted and I thank Ken Melman for teaching me sort of the conservative perspective on LGBT equality. And I've learned to talk about it differently. And it means I can do better when I'm outside of, you know, just my friends and sort of cohorts in the movement. So in that way, it's important. It is uncomfortable when they, come out and endorse Romney. And when they especially take the next step and help Ryan, it's uncomfortable. And my friends kind of come to me and say, can't you get them to change this? Aren't they pro? Why don't you go talk to them about this? And I say, no, you know, I'm pretty sure Obama's going to win. I feel secure in that. But I also, there's such value to be had in having true conservatives and true Republicans on the side of LGBT equality. The access that I've been given to their friends, to their communities, to be able to have those conversations, communities and groups that I never would have had access to, to help start to, you know, change minds.
What are the stories about LGBT communities that have yet to be told?
Is there any screenwriters in the room? Because I don't want anyone to steal this. There's so many. I mean, there are so, in terms, I mean, I do usually based on a true story stuff. So there's an infinite amount of stories about LGBT people in the same way there are straight families. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, it's kind of all the same thing when you get down to it. It's slightly different in the bedroom, but otherwise, you know, it's pretty similar. But I think, I mean, one of the stories I've always wanted to tell, I can't believe I'm telling you this, is the Byard-Rustin story, because I do think it's one that people have really forgotten, in the same way that Milk was felt completely forgotten when I started tackling that one. But also, I think that there's this, I like to call it, I don't believe it, but this, there's been all these attacks on sort of the black community during the Proposition 8 ballot initiative, blaming the black community and the Latino community for not coming out and supporting the LGBT community. And I feel like I want to make sure, see if we can in some ways heal that rift and look back in history to a time when we were working together. And of course, Byard bridges those communities in such a lovely way. And I just also like his philosophy of life and activism and, you know, the guy who brought us nonviolent civil disobedience to this country. Mm-hmm. You know, so I'd love to tell that story, but there are an infinite number of LGBT stories, and it's a forgotten history. I think that's what I want to get to. But we've been robbed of our history because of silence. We have so many great leaders whose shoulders we stand on, who got us here, and because of the silencing that's happened, because of the shaming that's happened, and because for so long no studio would greenlight a movie and publishers wouldn't get the books written or published or put out there and promoted, we've lost our history and been robbed of our history. And so I think it's not only that there's so much to tell, but that it's necessary so that young people know where we've come from, so that we don't repeat the mistakes that we've made in our movement, and we continue to move forward.
So I'm going to give you fair warning. This is going to be my last question before I open it up to the floor. So if you have any questions, please tee them up. So I get this question all the time, so I'm actually curious to know what your answer is. So when I lecture on college campuses or high schools, people always say, what can we as young people do for the movement? Mm-hmm. You know? So what's your answer?
I get that question sometimes, too. I mean, there's a lot of different answers. I think one of the things that one of the things that leaders in the LGBT community need to do more of is to get really specific with the younger communities about what they can do. Without naming names, there's some people who aren't really running things anymore, but would always express frustration that the young people wouldn't show up and they wouldn't do anything. And I said, well, you're the leader. Why don't you give them some instruction of what it is that would be helpful?
Like the Mormon church hierarchy does.
Well, yeah, yes, you know, for sure. We'll send them out on missions 2x2. But I found the absolute opposite, which is if you give young people something very specific that they can do, and you help break it down where the need is and how this is effective, they do show up and they do work very hard and they're very passionate about it. So, but you know, like with the play, I've loved being able to do this play because, you know, it's a big cast, and you go to all these community colleges and now high schools, and all the kids get a role, and all the kids get a piece in doing it. But they also get to invite their parents and their friends and their family. And one of the things about the play is make sure you're inviting the people who really need to hear this the most. And if they're conservative, make sure they know the hero of this play is Ted Olson, the guy who brought you George W. Bush. So, you know, they might like the play. And to start to change minds in that way. In Utah, it's a little different. Like with the young people out there, I go back to sort of a narrative of the Harvey Milk days about coalition building and about reaching out to unexpected allies. And those young people out there, I said, well, who do you want who frustrates you the most? And they're like, the old people. And I'm like, okay, you want the old people to like you more? And they're like, yeah, but they just won't. I said, well, I don't know. Let's figure out what you can do for the old people in an unselfish way. And so it's now, I love going out there at the first, in the winter, the first snowfall, and there's a group out of Utah State that now the BYU group is joining up with, amazingly, and they put on their big gay jackets and their big gay buttons, and they get gayed out of their mind, and they take their shovels and they go shovel the old folks' homes and the retirement communities and that sort of thing, and it inevitably starts conversations, and it's been really good for both groups. And I always say, when they say, hey, what do you want? You don't start talking to them about things you want them to vote for at the ballot box. Don't start doing that. Tell them your real story. I think this is a movement of storytelling. Tell them who you are. Tell them what your experience has been. And just say, hey, man, I just want you to know I live in your community. We share this community. I'm your neighbor, and we have family in common. And that's it. That's why I'm shoveling your driveway. I'm doing it visibly, but that's why I'm doing this.
So. Thank you. Questions? Yes, sir.
So, thank you very much for this incredible conversation. But Les, the question that kept coming up to me was, what gives you the voice to tell the stories of other people? Like, how does that come for you? And I was thinking about, you know, being able to tell the story of Ted being able to tell the story of Ted Olson, you know, who's so very different from you, you know, that's got to be one place that you know, where do you get that inspiration? And then certainly if you were going to tell the story of Bayard Rustin, you know, right, where does that come from? And particularly when people are going to challenge, you know, and irrespective of who the person is, when you tell somebody else's story, how do you do it?
Always, you know? Yeah. Well, for me, I mean, my process has always been as much as I can get firsthand interviews. I as much as I love biographies and I love books and I love doing that sort of research, it always comes with that author's slant and that author's voice. And so my job is to find out the real person's voice. More times, you know, with Ted, it's easier. I just hung out with Ted, and as you start to want to channel Ted in some way, and also I'm using the text from the trial, so it was much easier. But, you know, J. Edgar Hoover, for example, when I was doing the J. Edgar movie, it's you know, getting to know all of his surviving friends and getting the firsthand stories and getting them to do impressions for me and listening to as much of tape as I can and reading everything he wrote. And you know, in that case, it does become horrifying because you start to channel them as best you can. And that was really frightening, actually. But, you know, for me, it's you get as close as you can in a first... you know, to firsthand stories and try his best not to depend on secondhand stories. And one of my favorite tricks, if anybody wants to be a writer, is if you get, especially for things that have happened many, many years ago, because I find memory really unreliable, I would team up. I first interview people alone, and then I team them up and get two and three in a room. This is particularly important when the person's passed away or not there who you're depicting. And they start to correct each other's memory, and more importantly, they start doing impressions. And you start to get the language, you start to get the voice. And that's the sort of stuff that I do. And you know, at the end of the day, I also take the script and I'll show it to, like, say with Milk, to Cleve Jones and be like, does this sound like him? How's that? You know, I want it to be as close to the truth as possible.
My students accuse me of always calling on people to my left, so does anyone on my right want to chime in?
Right here.
Okay, great.
Hi, I have two questions. One of them is, my partner was an extra in Milk, and his check got kind of lost in the mail. Can you do something about
that? Is that true?
Second thing is, yesterday I had the chance to meet Ken Melman, who you referred to, who is former chair of the Republican National Committee. And he shared with me something I think he said in public, that within 2 years, with the right strategy, we can get the Employment Non-Discrimination Act passed. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, your buddy Chad Griffin said after the election, nobody should have any illusions about getting ENDA passed in this Congress. We still don't have the votes. Mm-hmm. So can I ask you to comment on that? And
yeah,
can you introduce the two of them and get them to chat?
Well,
so that we can get ENDA passed in this Congress.
Well, first off, they're very close, you know, very close because they're both part of our foundation, on the board of our foundation. And I called Chad and, you know, after that, because I, first off, my thing on ENDA, I'm a huge INDA. If there's anything I want to see get passed in the next 2 years, it's INDA. And it drives me batshit nuts, sorry for my language, when I hear people talk about it as this not so important idea because of marriage now, including people like Barney Frank, who I love and admire. But I'm like, you got to get behind INDA. And he'll say to me, but you know, are there really people out there losing their jobs and their homes? And I say, that is not the point. It's not that people are losing their jobs and their homes. And some people are. The important thing is people feel threatened that they're going to lose their jobs and homes, so they're not bringing their partners to the holiday parties this year. They're not out. They're not telling their stories. They're not dispelling the myths and the lies and the stereotypes that have held us back for generations, particularly in the places where they need to be held and need to be introduced the most, in the South, in some of these redder areas. And so it's very, very frustrating. If this is a movement of storytelling, we have to create an environment where it's safe for people to tell their stories. So I think INDA is, to me, one of the most critical things we can do on a federal level. So yeah, when I heard some of those comments from Chad, I was pissed off, and I called up, and he assured me, he said, no, I just want to make sure people know that we're working at a state level as well as a federal level, and he's assured me as well that, he's working with Ken on this sort of stuff strategically. So, you know, I don't know why he says that. I accept that at this moment it's true. We don't have the votes necessarily yet, but who gives a damn? That's what my job is, as someone who's helping change the culture. That's why it's great, the political theater that comes with a big case. It's amazing what's happened in the great work that's being done state by state in the ballot measures. I don't want to be anti-ballot measure. I think the ballot measures are incredibly important pieces of our narrative and creating a narrative. That hard work creates a narrative of where history is headed, right? That starts showing the inevitability of this movement. That makes it easier for those folks up there on Capitol Hill to vote for things like INDA. It makes it politically popular. And so I'll get very passionate about INDA. But I do think one of the things he's saying is make sure you're out there doing the hard work to shift the culture in a way that is overt, in a way that is sending a message to make sure that these folks that we're electing on Capitol Hill know it's politically advantageous for them to vote for something like INDA, so we do have the votes. And actually, Barney has always said the same things: we don't have the votes, we don't have the votes, and all gay and lesbian people get pissed off at him. And I say, well, get out there and do the hard work to make sure that we do. And I do agree with Ken that I think we can do that in 2 years. Mm-hmm. You don't agree?
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about that? Did you hear my question?
Yeah, that we overwhelmingly cast. Yeah, the only story I can tell about that, because it is frustrating, is when we were casting Milk, we went after and said that we wanted to have openly gay actors play those roles. One of the worst things that's still around in Hollywood is a community of agents and managers who still, to this day, encourage their actors not to come out. And do a weeding out process because they don't want their leading man to come out and jeopardize, you know, revenue. So they weed out people they think might be gay or lesbian. And that's still happening today. And what we found when we went out, because the studio, you know, focus was all in favor. The directors, producers, all of us were all in favor of casting openly gay and lesbian actors. We couldn't find them. And the ones that we did find, you know, weren't the ones who would green light the picture. So it was quite a frustrating process, and we found that the roadblock was at the agents and managers still. It's something that's getting better, but we're not quite there yet. In Milk, at least, we ended up casting all the homophobes with openly gay actors. So it's sort of this, you know, so when you look at who's playing what in that movie, all the people who are anti-gay are played by openly gay actors. But we had to go to Broadway to get them. We had to come out here.
So we have time for one more question. Yes.
I have a question for you.
Just one second.
I'd love to get your take on the kind of the erosion of the faith of rule of law that we're seeing kind of at the federal level. I work with a bunch of attorneys, and I think it's connected to the right's emphasis on government bad, government bad. And I'd love to get kind of your take on, you know, like the law in people's lives, which we've all day hearing about how important that is, and we all recognize that, right? But terms of kind of ongoing perception of how that's going to shift? Because I think it really, I think it has, but I'd love to get your take on that.
Yeah, it's a great question. It's a big question, so I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do it full justice, but let me just give you the beginning of an answer, and then maybe we can talk longer offline. So, you know, so if we just start with the Supreme Court, so if we look at the rule of law and the governmental body that has the highest approval rating, it's the United States Supreme Court. We've seen actually a declension in the approval ratings for the Supreme Court from 66% in the late 80s to 50% in 2000, Bush versus Gore, to 44% right before the Affordable Care Act decision. And I do attribute that to the idea that law seems to be swallowed by politics, and we've had so many partisan 5-4s from the court. And especially after Bush versus Gore, I found it really interesting that the mantle of the court as an immortal corporate body kind of slipped off of the court, and the justices became much more visible as individuals. So we hear stories about what Justice O'Connor said when Florida went for Gore at a Christmas party, you know, and, you know, Justice Breyer and Justice Ginsburg doing shuttle diplomacy. So they suddenly become much more legible as individuals, and I think that that's in direct, you know, relationship to the diminution of respect that people have for the court as the court, right? I think that the Affordable Care Act decision did something. We've seen actually an uptick in the approval rating for the court after Roberts, you know, went with the liberal side of the court. And here I'm not saying left or right or whether or not the Affordable Care Act decision was right or wrong. By the way, it was correctly decided, but, you know, leaving that to one side. What I'm saying is that Roberts did a really important thing for the institutional legitimacy of the court, and that we just need to see more of that. And the consequences of not doing that, of now just using the Supreme Court as a tiny example of the polity as a whole, if we see too many things being governed by politics rather than by the rule of law, that is something that is going to really diminish our belief in the law in the way that the belief in the Supreme Court has diminished over time. So I am very fearful of that. One thing that I will say with respect to LGBT rights is that I think that the next generation is going to be looking at attempts to engage in various forms of civil disobedience with respect to laws that you don't like. So I actually find this Manhattan Declaration that was signed a couple of years ago by, was drafted by Robbie George at Princeton and a couple of other religious leaders saying, we will engage in resistance up to the point of civil disobedience, right, to same-sex marriage along with abortion and other things. And I actually find that a little bit of a shocking, you know, thing for a lawyer, as Robbie George is, to say, right? And I think that it's at least incumbent on him to say what that civil disobedience is going to entail. You know, if he is a lawyer, is going to say, I'm going to disobey the law, right? And so I think that the fact that we see statements like that coming out and, you know, and matters that affect our community is something that is extraordinarily serious, and that these individuals should at least be forced to specify what exactly they mean. I actually asked a signer of the Manhattan Declaration what he meant by the civil disobedience, and he said he wouldn't actually engage in marrying any same-sex couples. And I was like, well, you wouldn't have to anyway, but that's not exactly like a, you know, letter from a Birmingham jail kind of civil disobedience act, you know, that you're going to refuse to marry two people who want you to marry them for whatever benighted reason that they might have. So I hope that's at least the beginning of an answer. But I think I want to end by saying the lunch is supposed to be kind of a hinge, you know, between the events of the morning where we talked more about politics and policy and law, and what's happening in the afternoon, which is more focused on culture and the arts. But I really want to give props to the Ford Foundation for being able to combine those two themes in a way that seems so seamless. You know, And I'll leave this kind of session of storytelling with a story of my own, which is one of our oldest stories, right, is Plato banishing the poet from the city. So in book three of the Republic, Plato says the storyteller has to leave the society because he's too much of a threat to the rule of law. And then what most people miss is that at the very end of the Platonic corpus, the poet comes back to the city and says, can you let me back in? This is in the laws. And Plato's statesmen say to the tragedians, yes, you can come in, but what you don't realize is that we ourselves, as statesmen, are storytellers in the poem that we tell as a state. So insofar as you can make your doctrines conform to ours, you can come back into the city, but if you can't, you can't. So I feel like what he's telling us at the very end of his corpus is that it's actually storytelling all the way down, that there isn't this rigid distinction in between law on the one hand and culture on the other, that both are acts of storytelling. And I really can't think of anyone who's done it better than Lance here. So with that, I'd like you to give me another round of applause for him.
That's sweet.